So, good evening and welcome to our study in soteriology. And really, I need to change the name to Reformed Soteriology, just because we're not dealing with all of the aspects of salvation, and there's much more to the work of salvation in our lives. Obviously, we'll be touching on fundamental ideas, but we're not doing everything, and it really is concerning TULIP and sovereignty of God. And so maybe this is more, the class title should be Reformed Soteriology. And so while we're just waiting for a couple more people to come in, we'll begin in 2 minutes. But I just want to draw your attention to, if you go to our website, Cloud Theological Institute, and then you click on the options here, get our content, and then you scroll all the way down to the bottom for get our content. We have the visual dictionary of theological terms, and these are actually, I'm posting the final like handouts for our study in Reformed Soteriology, so you can get copies of these. Now what you'd want to do is you want to right click, or if you have a phone or an iPad, you would just, so here, let me do it here on, so if this is my iPad right here, so if you're going to your iPad to get our content, you'd scroll all the way down to the bottom, and then so if you're on the computer, on that image, you're going to right click, save image as, and you get the image, okay? Full image, it's high resolution. And then if you come down here on an iPad or an iPhone, smartphone, you're just going to hold your finger on the image, and then you can save to your photos, and that'll save right to your camera roll. So you can have them on your phones, on your tablets, wherever. And these are really nice if you want to teach your children, or if you want to share with someone at church, or if you just want, if you're traveling and you want to review, these are really nice, easy ways for us to learn and to review theological terms. So we're going to be doing a lot more than just these. So we have here already posted sovereignty of God. I have two for theological terms related to the triune God. So we have sovereignty of God and also the mercy of God. So check that out. And then coming down here to theological terms related to salvation, here we have our notes from class. So I actually have all of them posted. So there's sovereignty of God. There's two handouts on total depravity. There's unconditional election. I've gone back and forth with just posting the full notes, because it's actually 3 pages for the unconditional election. Then we have limited atonement, we'll be discussing the next time I teach. Irresistible grace and perseverance of the saints. Don't look at those until we have the class, the workshop. So I went ahead and posted them just so that there's access to them. So just use that as a resource in your personal life, in your family life, or your ministry life. You could even do your own Sunday school lesson, like on perseverance of the saints, and then just use this as a handout to print out or to share later as a review. And essentially what we're trying to do here is give you a concise definition so it's clear, and then showing at least one reference in scripture where it really is being taught. And so a lot of theological terms, the problem is not that they're not true, it's just people can't make the connection. And because they can't make the connection, they're like, oh, you're just musing about something, or this is just your opinion. But if you really see it in the text, you're like, okay, it's there. It's strong, it's malakas, you know, it's much harder to disprove, and people would be more readily receptive to it. And I've seen that as the biggest struggle in the debate between biblicists and people that focus on theology. Not that they are saying different things, but that they're just coming from different perspectives. And because they're coming from different perspectives and talking from different perspectives, they actually talk past each other. Let's go ahead, and it's already time. So let's go ahead. Let's open with a word of prayer, and we'll begin our time. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for your grace, for your love, for your guidance, for your work in our lives. We want to give you all the glory and honor and praise. You are the sovereign God who saved us and called us. We were dead in our sins, and through your free grace, you called us, you chose us in eternity past, you saved us through your Son, you've sealed us through your Spirit, and we just want to give you glory and honor and praise this evening. Help us and guide us now that we understand these truths, that we would not use these truths to win arguments, but that we would first and foremost rest in your truth, that we'd share it with those around us. And most importantly, Father, may we proclaim your gospel to every creature and leave the internal struggles to you. In Jesus' name, we pray all these things through the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let's go ahead and let us get into super quick by way of review. So we've already done two studies. We first really looked at the sovereignty of God and how the sovereignty of God is God's ultimate lordship and rule over all things in the universe so that his will is supreme. And from that theological truth, which is real and true, we have this Ephesians 4, 6. If we can, let's memorize it. Then we talked about total depravity. Total depravity is that sinfulness and its corrupting effects and its state has spread to all parts of our humanity. It includes our mind, our hearts, our actions, our speech, and it also includes beyond just the individual into our systems of government. And so it's individual and corporate, and it's really pervasive, and it has to take the supernatural work of God to do the work to save us. This is not to say that he commands everyone everywhere to repent, but our condition is such that we don't have that ability, even though that the command, in the same way that we're given the command to obey God's law, we can't do it. It doesn't matter whether we can do it or not. The command is to obey the law. Now we're on to unconditional election. And so I will hide these notes so that you can't see that. But let's go ahead now. Let's go ahead and discuss unconditional election. So let me just bring up here. Okay, so let's do a quick just breakout storm brainstorming. Let's talk about unconditional election. So I want you to share with me your experience with this. Maybe you have your own personal questions. Maybe you're unsure if this is true or not. So just the impact that this doctrine has had on you. What are your reactions to it? What is it? What are the issues that people say with this doctrine? Anybody this evening?
Pastor Tim. Somebody, okay, the reform people, but somebody told that this is a unfair election. It's unfair.
That's good. It is unfair. Excellent. So we want to really contemplate that. It's unfair. And so the implication being this is unjust. Unjust, not unjust. Unjust. It's an injustice, unjust. Anyone else?
So my understanding, Pastor Tim, is God's elect the sinners unconditionally, regardless of sin they have committed.
So, and let's add here, because at this point many people would agree. Let's add a word in here, and I'm sure that you were meaning this. Let's add certain sinners. It's specific. It's not every single sinner he elects. There's a certain number of sinners that he elects unconditionally. I feel like that's a fair introductory definition. And so then obviously this will lead to that. At anyone else's experience with this doctrine, maybe you wrestle with it. Maybe what else have people said about it? I'll save my thoughts and comments just because I also have had experience. What else? Anyone else want to add?
Pastor Tim, some groups would say that you need to continue doing good works in order not to lose your salvation.
That's really good. So this is contrary to claims that we need to do things. And we're going to write this down. We need to do certain things. Thank you, Ellen. That's great. Certain things. And there's several categories of this. So some people will say our faith continues to save us. And don't get me wrong, the Christian life is a life of faith, but they would say that the faith and this faith is from us, the source. And we're gonna have to address that. Meaning to say that if you stop having faith or you lose your faith, you lose your salvation. That's really the sense in which I'm using this, that the faith is doing certain things, because we would agree 100% that we are saved by faith. So it's not that we're not saved by faith, that we're rejecting that. It's that the faith, if we can lose faith, and if we lose faith, we lose the salvation, we lose the election. Okay. And then what Ellen said was also excellent, is that we have to do good works. Right. And then the third would be that we have to do the sacraments. This would be very much in a Catholic context. And obviously there's overlap with the good works. But I'm thinking of, there is nuance there, because Catholics are big on sacraments. And then obviously some Baptists and some other Christians would be big on different good works. You have to go to church. You have to, you know, you have to make disciples, right? And so again, we don't want to minimize the commands, but if you're not doing those things, sayang, you've lost your faith. Excellent comment. Excellent comment, Ellen. Anyone else want to add to this?
What about the nuance with supralapsarian and infralapsarian?
Okay, so just share briefly. Can you share briefly about that?
Some groups would say that God elected sinners to salvation prior to the fall, and the other group would say that God chose to elect sinners unto salvation after the fall.
No, that's really good. So it's meaning to say that, that's really good. So meaning to say that, when precisely is the election, and is it only conditioned upon the fall? Meaning to say that God reacted to the fall. So the big wrestle here is reaction to the fall, right? Would you agree with that, Vincent?
Yes.
Excellent. Anyone else want to add? I feel like this is a good, really good, just laying out the groundwork of expectations. So anyone else want to add? I don't want to take away from anybody. Anyone else want to make a comment? So what we want to really highlight here is, as we think about these things, we always need to separate. We always need to separate these two things: what the text says and what are the implications. Right? So what the text says, it's what it says, right? What is that? And then we have to wrestle with what it means for us. What's the scripture text says, and what are the implications? Those are two different things, okay? A lot of the struggles, what happens is, a lot of it, people will read the text and they can see what the text is saying, but then the implications are too hard to bear. So then they change what the text says. And this is implicit. Everyone's tracking there with what's going on there. We want to focus on this evening. We really want to focus on this, and also this too. And then we want to focus on, as much as possible, we want to focus on reasons or qualifications surrounding this act. And then we also want to deal with practical implications, because there are some practical implications, and we really need to meditate upon them. Okay? We really need to meditate upon them. The practical implications are huge for us, and I want us to see that there is incredible benefit to the doctrine of unconditional election. There is incredible benefit to it. And then there's also a necessary response for us as well. So let's go ahead. Let us now when we get to answering this question, people can give a ton of different passages of scripture. our focus for this study has really been on just the book of Ephesians, because we're trying to show that Reformed soteriology, tulips with the S, with sovereignty, is not just isolated. And if you say, oh, it's isolated, then it's easy to reject because maybe it's taken out of context. We want to say that it's woven into the fabric of Ephesians, and it's not only theological, but it's very practical. So our solution this evening is going to continue in number one, Ephesians. We're going to continue in Ephesians. Okay. And so the specific solution that we're going to get at will be Ephesians 1:3-6. And people can go to Romans 9:9-11. And this is typically the classic text where everyone goes to, and people are so afraid. I was in one church where the one person was just like, you know, we're just gonna focus on Romans 1-8 and just end it there. another Bible study my wife was in, it was not a Reform context. They had one Bible study on Romans 9-11. And so it was very, oh my goodness. So Romans 9-11 is very malachas as well. I don't want to go there this evening because of our desire to stick in Ephesians, to stick with Ephesians, but then also just because there are some issues with Romans 9, because there's the history of redemption, and people will say, oh, it's not concerning salvation, it's just concerning the history of salvation, specifically related to calling. And so this is ministry, this is not salvation, and this is concerning Israel, it's not concerning all believers. So there's just some issues. Now, I'm not agreeing with those conclusions, but I'm just saying it's a little bit more complicated and nuanced. But for me, if you're to say, what is the strongest passage of scripture for unconditional election, my go-to is Ephesians 1:3-6. There's just no escape. There is no way out from this. So let's go ahead and let us look at Ephesians. Really, it's 4-6. I'll just begin in verse 3. We're going to focus on Ephesians 4-6. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in Christ with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places, even as he chose us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and blameless before him. In love, he predestined us for adoption to himself as sons through Jesus Christ, according to the purpose of his will, to the praise of his glorious grace with which he has blessed us in the beloved. Heavenly Father, add a blessing to your word and guide us now as we seek to understand it. In Jesus' name we pray these things. Amen. Okay, here we go. So, I don't know why I have 3. This should be 4-6. Let me fix this here. All right, so what we're going to do now is I'm using Greek just because the Greek is it's strong. Also, if you were to take this for a Greek class, we can use that. You don't have to know Greek. And as you see here, we have the English underneath. The word order is slightly out, but I'm sure that you can pick up what's being said there. And so let's just go phrase by phrase, clause by clause. This is one lengthy sentence, but there are There are clauses that are dependent. There's some relationship, and at the same time, they're self-contained. And I hope that you'll see what's going on here. So the first thing we want to do is we want to always just look for the main verb. So we have the main verb here. This is the action. He chose. And then we have the actor, which is also contained in the verb. That's typically the case in Greek. And so the actor is he. So let's unpack. What we'll do is let's identify first the phrases. Then we'll unpack each word. We'll come back and unpack it. The object is us. This is the object. The sphere or the realm is in him. So we have to identify who the in him is as well. Let's be thinking about that. I'm going to come back and ask you that question. Who is the him? Who is the he? And then we have this other qualification here. And this is a before the foundation of the world. Before the foundation of the world. So then this is going to be a time reference. And let's think about this word before and also the imagery of foundation. Okay. And so just looking at this clause, there's obviously a relationship to the preceding context. And really the preceding context is this is a benediction. And coming in this way, this is really giving a reason for why Paul is praising God. Okay. And so we'll just leave it there. We just don't have the time to look at verses 3, verses 1 and 2. We won't have the time tonight. But just to really lay this before us, he chose us in him before the foundation of the world. So we have to confirm chose is election, elect. But just looking at English synonyms, that's the case. And so I want to just say at the beginning of the study this evening that this clause, there's obviously relationships both preceding and succeeding, fair enough. But So what I want us to see here is that we're going to unpack each of these words and get deeper. But just from the beginning, he chose us in him before the foundation of the world is a statement of truth. It's limited. It's limited. It's time based. It's happened in history, right? Let's just do this. This is past action, past act, and then of course it's time based. Now, maybe this has already answered some of our questions from the breakout session, okay? But as far as the clearest, most explicit declaration of the view of unconditional election is right here in this one clause. We're going to further unpack it. I want to really stress that here. So looking at this clause here, this is unconditional election right there. So let's unpack this now. Who is the he? Anybody, who is the he?
God.
Okay, Father. I heard it. So God, and then very specifically, this is the Father. So he is the actor. Now, let us look at this word chose. You can kind of hear it. I'm just gonna say it in Greek. So you can see on my left, I'm just hovering over the word. So you can see the word, the meaning there. So the word is exelexato. That's the actual form in our Greek New Testaments. The Greek word is, you can see it on the left, and I'm just gonna write it out so you can maybe hear it. So it's Eklegomai. What does this kind of sound like? What does that kind of, anybody, what does eklegomai kind of sound like, the first part?
Election.
Election, right? Eklegomai. Election. Elect, right? So you really can kind of see it there. So actually, in word etymology, the Greek is the foundation for what will, then the Latin, then finally English, elect. So literally it's elect. So we could write here, he chose or he elected us. That's completely appropriate. So that someone, you know, I do not accept election because it's not in the Bible. Well, okay, you know, it's in your Greek Bible. It's in your Greek Bible. And you can see it right there. So a lot of people just don't understand. And so this elect, so the word can be elect, to choose, or to select. So there's just no way exelexato does not mean elect or choose. There's a comment here. Let me get the chat here. Oh, Paul says boom to the Jehovah's Witness. Okay, yeah, there you go. Yep, it's explicit. You cannot escape. The only way that a liberal scholar would escape is they would deny that Ephesians is original. They would say Ephesians is not original to the canon. That's how they get out of it. let's come on. Let's move on here now. So who is the us? Who is the us? Anybody, who is the us? Let's be very specific on who the us is.
The believers.
Okay, so the us, we can say they're believers for sure. Let's get more specific than just believers.
The elected.
Okay, but that's just what the text says. But I want to get more specific. According to the book of Ephesians, who is the us? Look at the surrounding context. This is hermeneutics. So now we're coming back into hermeneutics. So really this whole procedure is hermeneutics. So this is just applied hermeneutics. Who is the us? I need a strong answer that's in the context. Who's the us?
Gentiles, the Philippians.
Okay, so this is really good. So this includes Ephesian Gentiles. And how are they referred to as, Cloyd, Pastor Cloyd? Saints.
Saints, yeah. Yeah,
correct. Saints. So these are saints. Who else is included in the us? That's not enough, because that would just be you. Who else is included?
The
Jews believe.
The Jews.
Oh, okay, but
all.
Paul, that's what I'm looking for. There's Paul, right? Us has to include Paul. So just bear with me here. Let me fix this. So this also includes Paul. So now, who is the in him? Who is the in him? Now, so before we get to this, so some people will say, by yes, you are right, but really the implication is this could be also the world, right? He's just choosing the world, everyone who will believe. Does everyone see that? That's a claim. So what we want to ask is this an accurate claim to make? Is this correct? Can it be just everyone who will believe? And then the condition is then on this belief. Okay. Who is the in him? Anybody?
In Christ.
In Christ. And so when we say in Christ, what's the theological doctrine that we're referring to? If you're in Christ, you are what?
Saved.
Union with Christ.
Union with Christ. And so I'm going to put that down in a second. But if you're in Christ, in Ephesians especially, we've already had a brief discussion on this in the sovereignty of God. If you are in Christ, literally, what are you in? According to Ephesians. Anybody? I've said this in previous discussions as well. Any takers? Who are we? Vincent just said the saints who are at Ephesus who are faithful in Christ. Excellent. So these are, let's add faithful here.
Body.
What was that?
Body.
I heard it. Body? Did you say body?
Yes.
Who said that? Was that Paul?
Oh.
Ah. So this is in his body. In Christ, in his body. And so there's Christ is the head, we are the body. Whenever you hear the phrase in, it's in the sphere of Christ. Well, what's the sphere of Christ? His body. Okay, and so then obviously from there we see this is union with Christ. So if this is the case, everyone agrees that the the world being a part of Christ's body, this just doesn't fit. This just doesn't fit. Is everyone tracking there with me? Meaning to say that this is, that really the us has to be really limited to all the believers. I mean, those that believe. Okay, so he's speaking to a definite group of people, and he's saying, you have been chosen. Okay, is everyone tracking there with me? He can't be saying, what he can't be saying is, I'm just choosing every single person that will believe. That's not what the text says. Okay? Or I'm choosing the whole world, and then anyone who believes in the world, they're going to be in Christ. That's not what the text says. And we can confirm that because we're going to get more qualifications that really spell that out. But does everyone see? Ask a question if that does not make sense to you. It has to be very limited and definite. And this is going to set us up for the next limited atonement, okay? I hope everyone sees that. I haven't heard any questions or pushback. So let's continue on. There's the comments here. Okay. All right. So then now let's look at but again, someone is still saying, okay, but it's still everyone who will believe. Meaning, so we've crossed off the possibility for the world, and now we're going to ask the question about this condition here of will believe. So we clearly acknowledge that the us could not be the world, but what about the question of will believe? Meaning to say that the choosing is reactionary to the belief. Everyone's tracking there, okay? Everyone's good. Can you just give me a thumbs up or raise your hand? I just want to make sure everyone's with me. All right, good. Okay, I see some. All right, great. Okay, so now we have to address this issue of the reaction that he's choosing based upon belief, okay? So now let us look at the foundation of the world. So we have imagery of foundation. What is the imagery of foundation?
Underneath.
Okay, I heard Danny, and I love that Danny's here. Danny, what is a foundation? What's the big image that a foundation is a part of?
It's underground. It's beneath the surface. So
yes, I know.
Cannot be seen.
What's the bigger part that a foundation is a part of? What's the bigger part? Danny, you build these all the time. The building, it's a building imagery, diba?
It's the footing.
Yes. Okay, the big imagery is that of building or construction. This is construction imagery, and Danny is highlighting the part that the foundation plays. Okay, so when you're building, what is the first action of building, Danny?
We work on the foundation or the footing first before the structure goes up.
Yeah, so we got the foundation is the first action. After that first action, right? Then what would be the second action, Danny?
To put up the posts or the columns.
So we got the structure.
Structure.
We got posts. Then we'll have
beams and roof.
Then we got roof. Right? So we're moving down these actions, right? Now, after that first action, if there's a problem, right? There's a problem with the foundation, then the architect or the engineers have to react. Diba? There's a problem, there's then the reaction, right? As the structure goes up, there's a reaction, right? There could be a reaction. Diba? Have you had situations, Danny? I'm so glad we have an architect here.
Yeah.
Have you had situations where maybe the foundation was poured improperly, there's cracks, or the columns were installed improperly, and you had to make an adjustment to the plants?
We call that retrofitting.
Retrofitting. There you go. Okay. So then I mentioned another idea here. Prior to the first action, we have planning. Diba?
Yeah.
But during planning, so Danny refers to this as retrofitting. But prior to the first action, Diba, there can be no retrofitting. Diba, yeah. Danny?
Yes.
But, it cannot be. It cannot be.
We have to make sure that the foundation is correct in the first place.
So then coming here, he chose us in him before the foundation of the world. Is there any retrofitting in this statement?
There's no need to retrofit because when God chose us before the foundation of time, he has already has in mind. And of course, God doesn't commit mistakes.
Tama. It's unconditional, or we could say no retrofitting. And so then this aspect here cannot be. So God chose you in Christ before the foundation of the world without looking at whether or not you would believe. What is your reaction to that? When I say that, what is your initial reaction? If what is your initial reaction to that statement? God chose you without looking at anything you've done. What's our reaction? What ought to our action be? What should our reaction be? Why me?
Praise. Why me? Praise him.
Praise. Diba, we should be so humble. There's nothing I could do. Why me? There should be no place for pride. When you see these videos on YouTube with the Calvinists, you know them. They're the big chairs, and they kind of are smirking and laughing and all that, you know. There should be no place for pride. Now, and some of it's a little bit jabbing. Okay, fair enough. There should be no place for pride. We should be the most humble people. Why did God choose us? My goodness. And this prepares us for what is to follow. There should be no pride. There should be no big personality or very, what is owed? What's the word I'm thinking of? There should be none of this bombastic personality or it's like,
entitlement.
What was that?
Entitlement.
That's the word. Look at this here now. We have a purpose. This is a purpose clause. To what purpose has he called us in Christ before the foundation of the world? That we would be holy and blameless in his presence. Holy and blameless. Now, some people will say the choosing is not us personally. The choosing is only concerning whoever's going to be chosen will be holy and blameless. And for a while, I took that interpretation before I became a Calvinist. And so what I want to say here is that cannot be the case, because if you notice here, if the to be, and I think the ESV, the KJV translation messes it up. If the to be is just to be holy and blameless, the number one structural issue that prevents this from being the case is that we have, in this dependent clause, we have a we present. So the to be is not completing the idea of us being holy. It's an additional qualifying dependent clause. So essentially, we have two different clauses. We have two different verbs. Okay. Is everyone tracking with what I'm saying there? So I'm closing the door. So meaning to say, it's not he chose us to be holy. It's he chose us, period. To what purpose? So here, let's draw this. I just want to make this super clear. So what some people will say is this. They will say that what people will say is he chose us to be holy. And some translations will have that. And this is the wrong translation. What it's literally saying is he chose us, period. The purpose was that we might be holy.
Is the sanctification.
Yes, exactly. So what we have here is two different ideas. Phenomenal. Danny, I'm so glad you're here. So we have election and we have sanctification. And sanctification literally means holy. Election literally means choose. So anyone who is against these words and terminologies not being biblical just simply does not understand. Election literally is choose. Sanctification literally is holy or to be set apart. The difference in the use of words is merely that you have Hebrew, you have Greek, you have Latin, and you have English. And there's words that are being used from different languages, and they're just all being imported into 21st century Christianese. And that's the difficulty, okay? Everyone's tracking with me. Ask a follow-up question. We're going to take a break here, but I just want to take a pause. Any questions or follow-up, or this is making sense to you, ask a follow-up question or make a reaction, and then we're going to go on a break.
So question, sir.
Yeah, go ahead.
How about the verses that it said that blacked out? That means your name has been blacked out in the book of life.
Okay, Paul, great question. That's revelation, and it's just beyond this context. So then what we're wrestling with right now is our exegesis accurate? The next step can be, how do we fit this theology with other passages of scripture? Okay, so fair enough. So let me limit the questions. Concerning the exegesis, concerning our theological conclusions, do you have any questions with what the text is saying right here? We'll get you at the end, Paul, I promise. Anyone?
No.
It's clear. I feel like it's clear. I think it's clear. It's very malakas. And I hope and trust that from now on, all of us at least really seize the doctrine. And maybe you're not there to accepting it because you're wrestling, fair enough, but you can at least see it. For some of us, I hope that we stand on top of it, that you're like, wow, this is really biblical. And there's such practical implication there. If God has chosen us in Christ before the foundation of the world, you can go to bed and sleep well at night because he is on the throne and he is in control. Let's go ahead. Let's take a 7-minute break, get a drink, go to the bathroom. Okay, as we're getting back into the text, Paul has a question here. Can we say in eternity's past? Eternity's... If we want to talk about eternity past before the creation of the world and everything that exists, yes, that'd be fine, Paul. So let me just add a condition. This is before... the known universe. Let's just add this caveat here. Okay, let's go on now to having predestined us. So if ever you thought that there's going to be a way out, the next qualifier we see here is the action. So this is a, and really there's a gray area here with how these precisely relate, I've gone back and forth on this. We could say this is possibly a reason, or perhaps additional explanation. And so what we'd want to do here is we'd want to say predestined is an action that precedes election. So if we're drawing this out here in a timetable, we would say elect. What's preceding to election would be predestination. Okay. And what does predestination mean? Anybody, what does predestination mean?
Foreordained.
Okay, great. So let's write this out here. So we have foreordained. That's still somewhat hard. Vincent, how else can we say this? We could also say predetermined. Okay, predetermined. So he predetermined us. And then there's going to be a series of things that he's done for us. Again, this is the object. The first qualification is this idea of in love. And this speaks to manner. So people will often say that Calvinists are not loving. Calvinism does not breed love. The whole purpose of, or they'll say that God is an angry God, he doesn't love. Paul's comment here is that this whole event has been done in a context of love. It's all about love. And this makes great sense from our last week's study that we are utterly depraved as people, as a group of people, and yet God in his grace has predestined us to become holy. Coming down here, in a lot of translations, we have the word adoption. And I get the use of adoption. We're not part of God's family. Now we are part of God's family. Fair enough. I mean, incredible. But I like sonship because literally you have the word contained in the word itself. So I forgot to check this out. So we could also add up here, decide beforehand. Let's add this here. Decide beforehand. But then coming down here, this adoption, quia theseion, literally sonship, literally sonship. So if we do a quick search, look up in dictionary. Derivative, placing as a son, adoption figuratively. So this is sonship. So what this is speaking towards, this is another purpose clause. And this is speaking towards our sonship and daughtership. What does that include? If you become a son or daughter, what are the implications of being a son or daughter? List some implications of this, being a son or daughter.
Inheritance.
Ha. Rights. All rights. And especially concerning inheritance. What else?
Heirs.
Excellent. What else? Who is God? Who is Christ? In relationships to humanity. Who is Christ and God in relationship to humanity? Authority, right? He is the king of the universe. Christ, we're going to see later, we saw it in the sovereignty, right? Christ is Lord over all things. The Lord, God the Father, is sovereign over all things, and he's given it all to his Son in Christ through his Spirit, and we are the body of Christ. And so we have all the authority and all of the rights that Christ has as Lord. What else do we have? We have family. We're in God's family. For those who have lost fathers, mothers, spouses, children, we have new relatives, a special bond. So Daniel asked the question, how about the people that were not elected to heaven? Are they also elected to hell? So let's, Daniel, so that's a phenomenal question. I think Paul's still here. Paul's coming back in. Daniel, let's get to that question and also to Paul's question as well. And I would just say, as a quick answer to your question right off the bat, Daniel, question, do we have this type of specificity concerning people who are elected to hell?
Can you ask the question again?
Okay, sorry. So my question was, this is very specific, right? This election is incredibly specific, right? It's very clear. Do we have a passage like this concerning the opposite, that God is electing and choosing people to go to hell? Do we have a passage like that in the scripture that you're aware of?
I don't think so.
Yes, Pastor. I agree with you. So whereas God, Paul is very clear on election to heaven, there isn't this election, God chose people to go to hell. Okay. I mean to say everyone else. Now there are specific issues concerning Pharaoh, concerning other people. We can talk about that, but I just want to say, just to give you an initial answer, that there, we don't have a text where God chose the world to go to hell. He did this apart from their actions, and he did this to bring about their destruction, and there's nothing they can do, blah, blah. We don't have anything like that. What we do have is a description of who we are in Adam, that we are sinners, that we're breaking God's law in our hearts, in our minds, in our actions. And because of that sin, because of that state, the punishment, the right justice punishment for that is hell. Okay. So I want to, and maybe I'm doing a longer answer than initially I wanted to. I do want to stress that it's not necessarily a mirror image, that God is selecting different people and there's nothing they can do. It's apart from all their sin. He's just chosen them to hell. Does that make sense, Daniel?
Yes, Pastor.
Yes. So
thank you.
Yeah, you're welcome. So there is gray areas there. So we can have for another time double predestination discussion. I do want to stress that it's not in the same active sense if you were to see something like that. We don't have any passage like that. People are accountable for their actions, and their actions are what are sending them to hell. It's not God. It's not God doing that. So moving along here. So we have this sonship imagery, and then we have, not only are we in union with Christ, but the way by which we are brought into this relationship is through Christ. So this could be means, or this is the agent. Christ is the means by which we are brought into this relationship. And we're going to see later that it's through his sacrifice, it's through his spirit, it's through his work of righteousness. And in fairness, when I say later, you'll see later in the book of Ephesians. We won't really unpack this further. You can read and just see. Okay, moving along here then. So there's a lot of qualifications here. Then we have the object for the predestination. Who is the for himself? Who is
Father,
this? This is God the Father, right? And so this is the goal or the end. So the end of our salvation is not ourselves. It's not our pleasure. That's a byproduct. The end of our salvation is The end of our salvation is God. It's for his purposes. And we're almost done here. And then because I do want to spend some time in working together on how we could teach this, I want to help you do like a small group or something with this. So we're almost there. And then we'll have a reflection time. And also I want to have a discussion on how you could teach this in a small group. So moving along here, we have the goal. So we've got the manner, the purpose, the means, the goal. Here we go. So if ever there is a question, what is this is in agreement. If ever there was a question, we would say, oh, it's in accordance with faith. Is that what the text says, in accordance with faith? The answer is no. It's in accordance with, and ESV has purpose of his will, which is very malakas. But if you actually look at eudokion, eudokia, it's satisfaction, it's goodwill, it's approval, it's good pleasure. So really, we are created for God's pleasure. And it's his will. So coming back over here, what's driving predestination is... So behind election is predestination, behind predestination is God's goodwill. The purpose of election is for God. And then we have the end. Now, it's this another end goal. So the end goal is really driving at, in some way, there's a relationship here and here. Ultimately, it's further qualifications coming back from the predestined. So what's the for himself? It's agreement with his will. What's the purpose for you being for God? To the praise of his glorious grace. So I'm going to fix this here. So we got, and there is a relative relationship here between, for the praise of his glorious grace. That's the end goal. So we have glorious grace here. And notice this then. The grace is then described. The grace is then described here. Of this grace. Let's look here closely. This is the nail in the coffin. With which he has blessed us. So they use the word bless in ESV. I'm using the word freely gave. If we search this word here, this word eucharitosen, if we look up this word here, you can kind of see it. Let's blow this up here. Let's switch to BDAG. Caritao, it means to cause to be a recipient of benefit, to bestow favor, to be highly favored. So this is favored, highly, to bless. Let us, I want to look at this in a bigger sense here. Hold on here. This doesn't really get in cap. Okay, so here we go. So notice here, if you go to this word here, so this is the verb. So let's just write this out here. This is the verb. Carito. Right? This is the verb. To help us understand what this verb means, look at the derivative. Charisma. That's charisma is the gifts, right? Oh my goodness. So this is just charisma. Where do we get charisma? What is that? What's the famous, infamous word, charisma? Anybody? Anybody?
Charismatic.
Charismatic. Come on. This means gifts. So this is why I translate it here, and it's a possible translation. I translate it freely gave. Grace freely given. No condition. To the praise of his glorious grace, which he freely gave us in Christ. We are charismatic if we believe in unconditional election. Not funny. All right. So, Paul, Mark, are you a Calvinist yet?
Yes.
So, Malagas, what are your thoughts or reactions? What are the implications of this? Let's do brief reflection. Let's talk how we would teach this. So, reflection.
In view of this, a similar comparison is that a dead person cannot resurrect himself, cannot resuscitate himself. So it's really by God's election, through the work of God, that we are made alive. So it's an outside force that on our own we cannot resurrect ourselves.
100%. 100%. We need the work of God to save us. And we see how it's not just a reaction to the fall, that there's a deep plan going on, and this plan is before the foundation of the world. It's done in love. It's done for our sonship and daughtership with Christ, in Christ to the Father. It's for his praise. We should rest. Now, here's a question. Is there anyone who was chosen that doesn't make it?
No.
100% guaranteed.
Yeah. 100%
assurance.
The preservation of the saints.
Yes, we're going to get there. 100% assurance. And this leads to irresistible grace. This leads to perseverance. Go ahead. Anyone else want to add?
Pastor Tim,
go ahead, Mark.
So, Sir Tim, for me, it's all the work of the Trinity.
Excellent. Working together. Right, working together. We're going to see later that the Holy Spirit seals us. Go ahead. The other person, I think it was Pastor Cloyd or Danny.
Yes, it's Pastor. So, really encouraging, Pastor, because he chose us in him before the foundation, very foundation, before the foundation of the world, means before we created and before any. Anything that was created before that happened, we are already in the mind of God. So therefore, our destiny is secure in Christ.
Excellent. Already in the mind of God. I like that. Already in the mind of God. Paul, go ahead.
Hello, sir. Can you hear me?
Yes, I can. Go ahead. I can hear you. It's clear.
Can you hear me?
Yes. Yep.
My observation in our study of this night is I have said that the election in that way, regarding the election, is different than the man's way or man thinking. So I say that God's way is so very different that we cannot fully understand regarding this way in those.
How about this man's view of salvation? How about that? We're always trying to save ourselves. And this is a part. Excellent, Paul. Really good. Reflection. Vincent says, always in all of truth, all we can really do is praise his glorious grace. No, let's write that down. And I agree with that. There's nothing much we could do except praise his grace. Solo, soli Deo Gloria. So let's move on then to our reactions. I have several reactions for us to think about. Number one, I shared this before. These should leave us to number one, humility. What are some other reactions to those who don't have this belief yet? We definitely should be humble, and as we should be doxological with what Vincent's saying, that is praise focused. What are some other reactions that we should have?
Gratitude, Pastor Tim.
Yeah, gratitude. Beautiful. Beautiful. What else? Very nice. I like that. That's really good. Anyone else? What else do we have?
Security.
Assurance.
Security.
Assurance, security. We should not have a view that we're going to fall from grace. This is not to say we have perfect faith and you will be going through doubts. Every one of us has gone through doubts. If you've been in life, in ministry, you've gone through a time of doubt. But know that if we have believed, we are in Christ, that Christ will go and find you and bring you back. And so there should be incredible assurance. There should be no doubting. What else do we have here? Paul, go ahead. Paul, then Pastor Cloyd, go ahead.
We don't need to have a self-entitlement.
Yes. There should be no pride. No pride. Go ahead, Pastor Cloyd.
Yeah, embrace these truths, Pastor.
Grace to others. Excellent.
Pastor Tim.
Danny.
Yeah. This means we have to have the zeal for evangelism. Because how can they believe? It was Romans 10:14. How can they believe unless the gospel is preached?
We should have an incredible zeal for evangelism, Danny. Thank you so much. I was waiting for it. Because we have the confidence, Danny, you don't have to try to convince. You preach the gospel and the Spirit does the work. And we say, let's see what God will do. Let's see who God will bring into the fold.
Romans 1:16 is the power of God to bring salvation. Yeah.
Excellent. So then that leads to number 8. We should be patient. We should not be strong-arming people or angry, like, why didn't I not believe? We should be patient and we should be prayerful. Because it's God who's going to do the work. Go ahead, yeah. Danny.
It also happened to us, even to me. It happened. That's how it happened. The gospel was shared to me in 1975, and it's only 89, 14 years after that I fully understood the message.
Yeah. My goodness, it's true. So a Calvinist, someone who holds to unconditional election, many things that you see on the internet, like some of the pastors are angry, they're yelling at people. You know, I am becoming more and more like we should not be yelling at people. I'm not going to mention the names, but you know who they are. They're so angry. Oh, you're so backslidden, blah, blah, blah. It's like, no. They're caught in the snare of Satan. Let's encourage them as a brother or as a sister, or as an older parent. Let us pray for them. Let us be patient and prayerful. This anger, there should be, when you're angry, it's because, and we all fall into this, and I've been angry before. It's because we think it's all up to us. And yes, there's true that there is a righteous indignation, fair enough. But many times we don't see our own sin and our own struggles. We just want to look at everyone else's sin and struggles. Sayang talaga. Paul, go ahead. So let's talk about for a moment how we can, maybe you want to do this with your children, or maybe you want to do this in a small group or a Sunday school. Let's talk for a minute. How can we teach or preach this? So maybe how could we orient this into an outline to preach or teach? Anybody?
Just the hermeneutics method.
Yeah, so let's move this from this time to I want you to go out and to do a small group. How would you prepare an outline? What would be your outline here? How would we go about this? So let's talk for a moment about lesson plan as well. So proposition, I would want to say God chose us in Christ to be his sons and daughters. And then I would orient this not in chronological order, probably. So this is the main idea. And then I would answer the question why. We could answer questions of when, why, how, and what. So then you have a time, you have a reason, you have a means, and you have a goal. So this would be the big idea. So then maybe, or also, let's just add another what up here. What is it? What is it? So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 points. Okay. Is everyone tracking there? Does that make sense? Ask a question. Does that make sense what we're doing here? So maybe this isn't a strict homiletical outline. Yes, I'm sure.
Yes, sir.
Go ahead.
It's like that the making that teaching or lesson plan is that in the minutes or in observation regarding the passage.
Yeah. So you want to typically answer one question here because it's so deep. I'm actually going to answer. We're going to answer several. You'd answer several questions. Yeah. So, you know, it's slightly different. And I would go through here and just talk through these different. We could even talk about manner as well. Right.
Sure, Tim.
Go ahead.
Good question. God chose us in Christ to be his sons and daughters. It's the preaching idea, right?
Yes, that's the big idea.
Okay.
Yeah. It's so that's the declaration. So what I would want to say is, so just to be really clear here, let's just write this out here so it's really clear. We must accept and rest, or you could just say trust, in the truth that. So then this is the truth that they're accepting. God chose us in Christ to be his sons and daughters. Okay. And then we could answer the question of, we're just going to explain. So the one comprehensive idea is what is election? When is it? How is it? For what purpose? All those different things. Now, this is not typical. It's slightly different than our basic hermeneutics class. And the reason for this is that sometimes there's very basic and you can have a big outline. This is probably one of the most deep and dense theological truths in all of Scripture. So I want to take my time working through this so people really understand. Sometimes we'll go fast with large blocks of text and sometimes short. This is a time where it's very short. So I would say we must rest and accept and rest in the truth that God chose us in Christ to be his sons and daughters. What is election? So what is it? What is election? When did it happen? What is the reason for it? And then you're just looking at those different relationships here and then explaining that. Okay, maybe you want to change the order there. And a lesson plan would be similar here. So lesson plan, I would probably have a brainstorming session asking them about, so when I do my lesson with us concerning what they understand about election, then I would read the text, give a definition, and then exposit the text. So then that's where these handouts come in. So if you come back up to here, if you want to use our handouts, I will post the full handout from our workshop. But that's where these, I would maybe read the full, do a brainstorming session before you share this, or maybe you're just having this as your outline or as some, turn this into some bullet point text. And then you're just working through this. You can actually put this up, you can put this up on a screen to discuss, or you could just use a whiteboard, or you can just talk through it. Okay, you want to exposit the text, then you want to have a reflection time, which includes next steps. Does that make sense? How there's a slight, there's these are related but different. Any follow-up questions or comments? Is that making sense? Ask a question or make a follow-up question or a follow-up comment.
Question, sir.
Yeah, go ahead.
Lesson plan, can we put also that in lesson plan, can we put illustration there?
Yeah, for sure. Yeah. The lesson plan really helps us give a guide through. So with lesson plan, you with the exposition of the text, you want to talk about the structure. You want to talk about the word meaning. Identify persons. And you also want to explain the theological truth. And then also if you want to go really big, you want to also have memorized passage. That's part of the next steps. God chose us in Christ before the world's foundation that we should be holy and blameless. And maybe that's all you want to have them memorize, or maybe you want to have memorized the rest as well. So great. Anyone else want to add or make a comment? Mark first, then Paul. Go ahead, Mark.
How about application? Do we put application in every question or in the bottom of every question?
Yeah, no. So if I'm preaching this, I'm just explaining, and then in the conclusion, I would explain, but have one main idea. One main idea per. Mean to say you have one major point for what is it? When is it? One major point. And of course, you maybe want to talk a little bit more. So for example, we had the building imagery, talk about what a building imagery is. Do you see what I'm saying? Or the sonship imagery, what does sonship include? Daughtership include? The idea of inheritance, those different things. In the conclusion, repeat. Main idea. And give next steps. So this is really where the application, you can do application. Does that make sense?
Yes.
Anyone else want to add? I think Paul. Go ahead, Paul.
I'm just asking the question. Can we put also a lesson plan just for end, right?
Oh, yeah. I'm so sorry. Yes, absolutely. So we also want to, I am so sorry. So also I want to proclaim the gospel. And I, oh my goodness. Thank you so much, Paul. You are a lifesaver. Somewhere here or here and somewhere in here, we want to proclaim the gospel. So, I want to do that this evening here. So let's go ahead. I want to just declare the gospel for us. To the praise of his glorious grace with which he has blessed us in the beloved, in Christ, we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of our trespasses according to the riches of his grace. Brothers and sisters, this is the gospel. Rest in this truth. This is the means. So maybe you want to really put this in the means here. The gospel is the means by which in time and space we are brought into union with Christ. Although it happened in eternity's past, as Paul mentioned, in before the foundation of the world, in the election, in the predestination, in the will of God, in time and space, in the gospel, we are brought into union through the blood, the sacrifice of Christ, which is the forgiveness of our sins. Excellent. I'm so sorry, Paul. You get the gold star. I apologize. I almost fell short. Awesome. Paul gets the gold star. Excellent. My goodness. Anyone else want to add? Amen. Glory to God. Paul got the gold star. 100%. The student has become the teacher. Woo! Let's close in prayer. And if you want to stay in chat, and I'll share the notes later today. And I really want to stress for you that Ephesians 1, 4-6 is election. And it is for our good. And we need to be humble, patient. And as Paul and Danny stressed, we need to be proclaiming the gospel, resting in the gospel, resting in this incredible truth that forevermore we are in union with Christ. We are in his body and we have nothing to fear. Heavenly Father, give us eyes to see and ears to hear, and give us the actions to put this into practice. Now may the love of the Heavenly Father, the one who has blessed us in Christ with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places, and the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the one who sacrificed his life, his blood for our sins, live the perfect life which we could not live. And may the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, the one who, by which God seals us for the day of redemption, may these be with you all. Amen, and go in peace.